Okay, if we can get started, can I welcome you to this meeting of the Public Petitions Committee? There is only one item on the agenda today, a consideration of new petitions, but we will be considering a total of 9 petitions. The first 6 petitions will be considered without taking evidence from the petitioners, and I shall invite members to comment on each petition in turn and suggest any action that we should take in response to the issues that are raised. The first one then is petition 1606 on forcing Scottish councils to collaborate regionally on schools and roads. This petition is the first of 3 to be considered today that have been lodged by Peter Gregson on behalf of Kids Not Suits. It calls on the Scottish Government to allocate funding to local authorities in a way that encourages them to share services, particularly in relation to schools and roads. Members will note that shared services were considered by the Local Government Committee in the previous session. The petitioner has provided additional information in advance of our consideration today. Can I ask members for any comments on the petition and what actions we may take as a committee?
I was under the impression that there's quite a lot of local councils already collaborate. I certainly know in my own constituency there's a collaboration in certain services. I don't like the word force, I'm going to be honest with you. I think that's a bit emotive.
Okay. I agree with Brian. I think, to force Scottish councils to do anything at this particular time when, cash is strapped, I think is not a good idea. And I think some local authorities do share services already, so I'd be wary of forcing this issue through at all.
Okay, any other views? Angus?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Clearly attempts have been made in recent years to encourage councils to share services, but with limited success. But I reckon there's a strong argument, for example, for shared directors of education, and there's certainly an appetite in government, I believe, to centralise management of education, decentralise management of education. However, it would seem that primary legislation would be required to get that through. So I'd certainly be keen to hear the Scottish Government's views before we take any further decision on the petition.
Chair, can I suggest also that we might suggest writing to COSLA and the local authorities for their opinions and views?
Okay, well, it would be useful to know from them what progress has been made.
Yes.
On sharing services. Yeah. I think if we write to Scottish Government also to find out where they are in relation to public sector reform, and we may want to write to the Community Local Government Committee as well, just to see how they are they going to be looking at this issue, because Angus McDonald makes an interesting point around education. In the Education Committee, we are currently looking at the proposals around devolving power down to schools. We know that some local authorities actually don't have a director of education any longer. They've bulked up their responsibilities. So you wonder how these discrete services kind of manage through all that shared services work. So I think that might be a useful way to take it forward. Any other suggestions? No? Okay, thanks very much. And thank you to the petitioner for that petition. If we can move on. Petition 1607 on congestion charging in major Scottish cities. This is the second of Mr Gregson's petitions. This petition calls for legislation to introduce congestion charging in major Scottish cities, and the petitioner has provided a further written submission in support of his petition. I'm obviously keen to hear comments from members. I do note that there's been some discussion just in the last couple of days on the issue of congestion in Glasgow. And I was in the Parliament during the period where they attempted to get congestion charging in Edinburgh, and it was by referendum. And it was, I think it was controversial, would probably be pretty accurate at the time. So I think the petition is addressing this question: that is congestion charging a good thing? And if it is it feasible to do it through a referendum, or is it possible to give the powers to local authorities to make that decision without a referendum or a consultation? So I'm happy to hear people's views.
Chair, my initial reaction to it would be quite against it. I think I think we all would like to see, you know, the traffic in our city centres reduced dramatically, if nothing else, for health reasons. I think there are other ways that we should explore doing that. I say my gut is to not have a congestion charge. It's massively unpopular in London. And I'm not sure, I know in this, the petition documents it says it's been very successful. I'm not convinced that's true.
I'm not sure if we do know what the position, how massively unpopular it is in London, because I've also heard people saying that actually people have accepted it, that it's something that people have come to terms with. But certainly at the point where it was being implemented, I think there was a great deal of controversy. It might be something that would be worthwhile even just checking out, I suppose.
How would we do that? You know, could we ask the Mayor of London or whatever? Could we write to him?
We could do that. And I presume we could write to Scottish Government local authorities to ask them their view, because it does seem to be this, the petition seems to me to be focusing on the question of if congestion charging is a means of addressing emissions and so on, have we actually got a power that nobody's going to use because it's not doable?
I mean, according to our research, that legislation does already exist. It's just not being used widely, so it really is then up to the local authority to implement it if they want to, is my understanding of it. The petitioner's asking that local authorities should not have to consult prior to introducing a charge, so I think that would be very unpopular.
I think it's very much a local authority matter to deal with, Chair. And they have the ability to introduce the congestion charges anyway. Yeah. And it goes through a standard TRO, the traffic regulation order, etc., consultation period. It's all, the mechanisms are all there, so I don't think it really...
Writing to them to ask why, in, say, Cosler, for example, in their view, why this is not being... why is this power not being used? Clearly there are issues of congestion in some of the cities.
That's a fair comment, yeah. I'd support that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If we are going to write to COSLA, given that there's four other local authorities here stand alone in another group, it might be an idea to write to them as well, just to give them their place.
That's a fair point. Okay. I mean, maybe I think we can leave it to the clerk to decide which would be the most appropriate authorities to write to. I don't know how much congestion charging is required in certain bits of Argyll and Buttes. Okay, if that's agreed, thank you very much. And now moving on to petition 1608 on wholly owned national private pharmaceuticals. This petition has been lodged by Martin Keatings and calls for the Scottish Government to create, own and operate a medical manufacturing research facility within Scotland which focuses on producing medicines which meet the needs of Scotland's population. I'm interested in people's views on the petition and what actions we might take.
It's an interesting financial question here, Chair. Could we create a pharmaceutical company in Scotland that could had the financial muscle to create some of the medicines that we use on a regular basis?
Mm-hmm. I think there is an issue of costs.
I attended a meeting on drugs, medicines the other night here in the committee room, and it's an extremely expensive operation, and I don't think it's really incumbent on the government to set up some nationalised business. I think the pharmaceutical companies are there ready to do the work. But what I would suggest, Chair, is that, as I say, that write to the industrial bodies such as the British Generics Manufacturing Association, the Association of the British Pharmaceutical Industry, for their views on that.
Agreed.
Yeah, certainly agreed, Convener. Having read the briefing that we received, I notice there's no mention of the issue of state aid in any venture like this. I've been told more times than I care to remember the number of good ideas that come up that are shot down by the issue of state aid. Of course, post-Brexit, state aid may not apply, so it may not be an issue, but it would be good to get some further information on that, just to see if there would be a state aid issue.
I think this is a fascinating issue, and even just getting the opportunity to get the briefing from the clerks on the whole complexity of the area. And
it's a huge, complicated area.
And you can see why people would be, why the motives of the petitioner in terms of trying to find a way of getting medicines as cheaply as possible and as effectively as possible with as little. But, you know, I think it's a quite a complex area. But I think if we, it would be worth maybe writing to the Scottish Government, because they will have a view on state aid. They will have an understanding of that. They may even have looked at the option and decided not to go there because it's so complex. Even just managing the process of transition, you would imagine, would be hugely difficult. So if I can suggest then that we write to the Scottish Government, and has been suggested to the pharmaceutical organisations. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, if we can move on to petition 1609 on NH Scotland treatments. The fourth petition for consideration today has been lodged by Robert Marks. It calls on the Scottish Government to refuse treatment to NHS patients for illnesses and conditions that are self-inflicted. Members have a spice briefing and a note by the clerk which sets out some background to the issues relevant to the petition. And therefore I'll open it to comments from members on how we take this petition forward.
I understand where the petitioner comes from. I've heard this argument before, but I think in modern society, I don't think there's any room for refusing treatment for anybody, no matter what. I think isn't that the point of the NHS, is that they get treatment free at the point of contact. And I think. I think that who's going to make that decision as well? I think that then you get into a whole mess. Who's going to play, you know, judge, jury and executioner at that point? And I think that's certainly something I wouldn't like to pass on to any of our NHS staff.
That's my view as well. It's the whole thing about determining causation is the big issue. I mean, he cites examples of smoking, you know, or alcohol. Well, you know, you can argue that they themselves, they're addictions, so they are illnesses, so why shouldn't they be, you know, treated if they've caused even a subsequent illness? I think it's not a road I would want to go down.
I agree with that, Jen. I also think we have this big issue of mental health coming in, and I think a lot of this is behind that, and therefore I think it must be the NHS's ethos and doctors' medical profession is to help all those that need help.
While at the same time, I think, expecting NHS and others to promote the idea of healthy living, well-being,
yeah, absolutely.
And sort of
prevention.
I think that's definitely the way that I think future we need to go anyway. Mm-hmm. It's certainly not punishing people. It's certainly not the way forward, I think.
I think there are circumstances where people are refused treatment until, I mean, presumably it's a clinical decision about you won't get an operation until you've lost weight and so on, which is
safety reasons and for their own health. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do we want to take it forward, or do we think we want to just?
I wouldn't suggest we take it forward, to be honest.
What are the views of the other members of the committee?
I'm not in favour of taking it forward.
No, I'm not in favour of taking it forward.
Well, I would have been keen to seek the Scottish Government's views rather than close it down right away, but if it's the feeling of the committee to close, then I'm happy to go with that.
The one option would be to write to the Scottish Government and ask them, A, have they considered this, and what's their definitive position on it, and what is their public health programme in terms of addressing these questions?
I think it's worth getting the views of the government first before.
Yes.
In terms of how you frame that question, then it's not. I think we know what the answer would be. Come back in terms of would you refuse treatment? But if you're going to frame it around what other avenues are available to help you know, people with alcohol addiction or with smoking addiction, then I'm okay with that. But,
I think what's behind the petition is this idea that are we wasting NHS resource, and this is way, it's one way of addressing it, but actually, yes, if people are getting to the point where they're becoming ill because of addiction or whatever, or poor lifestyles, then that is a burden on the health service, but there are other ways of addressing it rather than simply refusing the treatment. And it'd be interesting to know what the Scottish Government sees their role in terms of that early action, prevention, early intervention. Is that agreed?
Okay.
Thank you very much. The next petition is petition 1610, an upgrade of the A75. This petition has been lodged by Matt Halliday. It calls on the Scottish Government to upgrade the entire A75 to dual carriageway. We have a note in this petition and a background briefing, and one of the things noted in the briefing material is the recent transport summit that was held in Dumfries and Galloway. I wonder if members have any comments on this petition and what actions they may wish to take.
Summit.
Indicate who was there.
Lots of people.
Or was it hosted by the Scottish Government?
It was hosted by the Scottish Government. Hamza Yousaf and the Deputy First Minister chaired the meeting. There was obviously, apart from sort of local MSPs, there was representatives from the councils, representatives from the ferry ports. Very well attended meeting. Certainly, you know, in excess of 100 people there, and there was very good discussion around the A75. It's a long-standing issue. And there was one of the points made that it's a Euro route that takes from the west coast of Scotland all the way down to Barcelona, I think, and it's the only part of that. we'll not mention seven then. It's a Euro route all the way down to there, and it's the only part of that route that isn't dualled. There's a heavy use of sort of articulated lorries. I think it's about 25% of the traffic there is heavy goods vehicles coming off the ferries. Mm-hmm. And it's also a major route south and north for goods coming into the country. So I think the feeling was that, nobody spoke against it. They're very positive in terms of dualling the A75. But it was left as a discussion with the chair.
And where are we in terms of commitments of the Scottish Government?
There was no commitment to do it. There's a commitment to look into it. And I think that in terms of this commitment, it seems to me that part of the A75 is long overdue, being upgraded. Having heard the evidence across the board, and especially given the, I think it's the third busiest port in Britain, and also down south, there's a lot of money being spent on the infrastructure and other ports down there, and the inference was there's a danger that we lose some of the traffic through the port, so. I think most people were in favour of having it dualled as a government, understandably, at that. They're not going to commit to that at that time at that meeting, but I think the commitment was to look at it seriously.
Okay. Any other comments?
Again, just really support what Brian's. It's clearly a crucial road, and it's certainly worthy of us inquiring as to what position is with an upgrade.
Okay. Absolutely, not only does it connect the south and Barcelona, but also connects across to Newcastle and connects into Holland, so it is a very important artery, and having been a user of it for many years, I absolutely support it.
Just on that, convener, the E18 also travels up into Scandinavia as well, and having been on the E18 over there quite a bit, It would certainly seem that we are the poor relations when it comes to the A75 section of it. So, yeah, there's certainly room for improvement.
Okay, I think we can agree that this is an important issue and that we should write to Scottish Government to seek their views and petition, perhaps a follow-up from the summit and even the timetable for their making a decision on whether they're going to upgrade. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for that. We now move to petition 1614 on adult consensual incest. This is in similar terms to a previous petition lodged by the same petitioner. That petition was considered and closed by a predecessor committee at its meeting on the 26th of January 2016. That committee closed the petition on the basis that, quote, the Scottish Law Commission undertook a report on this issue as recently as 2007 and concluded that the majority view at that time favoured retaining the offence and the current definition. Do members have any comments on the petition and what actions they may wish to take?
Close the petition again, I think.
I'm very much in favour of closing this petition.
I'm in the same similar, closing the petition.
Totally agree under Rule 15.7 of standing orders.
Okay, if that's agreed, we can agree to close that petition. And we can now have a short suspension before moving to hearing evidence on the remaining three new petitions on today's agenda. We can recommence. We're dealing with petition 1605 on whistleblowing in the NHS, a safer way to report mismanagement and bullying. This is a petition lodged by Peter Gregson on behalf of Kids Not Suits. The committee has received correspondence from Accountability Scotland in support of the petition, and Mr. Gregson has also provided additional information in advance of his appearance before us today. Can I welcome Peter Gregson to the meeting? Thank you for attending today and for the additional information you have provided. You have the opportunity to make a brief opening statement on your petition, after which we'll move to questions from the committee. I would ask that the opening statement, as well as the questions and answers, are kept focused and succinct. This will ensure that we're able to explore relevant points and make sure we have time to do the same for the remaining petitions on our agenda. People will be aware that we are strictly confined in terms of time because we have to finish by 11:30, as we're not able to sit at the same time as the plenary of the Parliament. So if I can ask you, Mr. Gregson, for an opening statement.
Right. I come here to you today as a taxpayer, someone who pays for public services. I was last before the Petitions Committee 3 years ago, and at that point it was also about whistleblowing. That was trying to get councils to implement whistleblowing policies. At the time, I'd just been fired from Edinburgh Council for gross misconduct. I'd blown the whistle. I'd written to a councillor about head of schools, leading Morton Hall inquiry. I worked in housing. This was outside my job. Again, I'd written to the council as a ratepayer. The council happened to know I worked at the council, so sent the letter to my boss, and I was immediately suspended. So that thereafter, the council treated me as a whistleblower, though I maintain to this day that I wasn't really a whistleblower. I was just a concerned, unhappy ratepayer. But no, the council treated me as a whistleblower. Now, at the same time, I'd done other things. I'd asked Unison AGM. a motion about implementing a whistleblower hotline at the council. I'd been involved in my own time in campaigning against the closure of Castlebury High School, but I didn't know why I'd been suspended. All I'd know is that I'd done something wrong. The council has a huge amount of influence in our lives, like most public sector bodies. I was banned from my son's school. I was banned from libraries. I was banned from going anywhere that was owned by the council without seeking permission. And I think all those who work in the public sector, you consume services as a taxpayer, but if you fall foul of your employer, your right to those services are compromised. Now, the law allows the employer to do as they wish in matters of employment. So the council was able to troll the internet for filth about me, using British Telecom and public funding to pay for that. That's what employers can do, whether it's any public sector employer. And they found I'd written an email to a Miami foundation where I'd compared the councillor through a US film called The Corporation. Because I think, and this is pertinent to any reflection on whistleblowing, is that big organisations, when threatened, I maintain, respond in a psychopathic manner. There's a lack of empathy and emotions. There's a lack of conscience. There's no sense of guilt. There's often a history of victimising others. The body acts as it chooses. There's few constraints. There's an inability to learn from past mistakes. These are all characteristics of a psychopath. The troll found this email, and I was fired 4 months later. Sorry. Yes, it's all relevant.
I wonder if you can focus on the petition, which is dealing with whistleblowing in the NHS.
But I think I'm trying to explain to you the cost of whistleblowing. You know, unless you understand the cost of whistleblowing, you can't consider this petition, because the cost of whistleblowing is something that we all pay for. Do you get my drift? You know, everybody pays for public services. If those services aren't working properly for whatever reason, we all foot the bill. Do you accept that?
I suppose what I would say is, I think your petition offers a practical series of suggestions about whistleblowing, which we'd be keen to focus on now.
Okay. All right. You've ruined my speech. I think, well, particularly the council, I would say the costs were not just personal. I would say that the costs of the process were about £50,000. This brings me on to the petition. I mean, the costs of suspending whistleblowers at the NHS are phenomenal. Jane Hamilton, the doctor at the heart of the St. John's inquiry, she was off work for 4 or 5 years. The costs of employing locums to take her place was £1 million. You know, that's a lot of money. So whistleblowers lose their job, their reputation, their family life. I lost my home, I lost my family. Taxpayer loses too. And I want you to consider these costs when considering my petition. I think, you know, my understanding that where the mechanism exists, the best way to bring concerns about inefficiencies or inadequacies in the public sector, if you're an employee, is to route it through a hotline. What the NHS has at the moment is a helpline. And that more or less tells you to go back to your manager or to go to the trade union. And this is a problem. Last week, this was published by the Northern Ireland Quality Regulation of Quality Improvement, who oversees health and social care in Northern Ireland. And they came to the same kind of conclusions as I did, that the fact that the helpline is getting fewer and fewer calls doesn't necessarily mean that the service is getting better and better. I mean, NHS Scotland's facing £40 million a year in compensation claims from staff and patients. It's a huge amount of money. And, of course, the staff are in a position to help cut that cost. This publication, which was very interesting, they talk about helpline. I don't think they really understood the impact of what we've got in Scotland, because we've had a helpline for 3 years, and the level of complaints haven't gone up, they've gone down. And I wouldn't say that's necessarily because the service is getting better. And they actually point to testing the silence. They say that bodies, if they're getting fewer and fewer complaints, why is that? There needs to be some way of testing the silence, and there isn't any at the moment. There are, the staff survey indicates that only 57% of staff feel comfortable about speaking up if there's problems in the NHS workplace. Now that means almost half aren't. You know, that's a phenomenal amount. And if they're not using the helpline, then what is happening? I think there are a number of issues here which are very much about how you deal with whistleblowing in the public sector. And I argue that having a helpline that refers you back to your manager isn't the answer. What you need is a mechanism, a system that brings your concerns and takes it off the shoulders of the whistleblower. Once you've lodged your concern, whether you choose to do that anonymously or not, that concern should then go to the decision-making body. And the point of employing a hotline is that they can filter out stuff that's into major and operational matters. So if it's operational, i.e., you know, such and such has got a bigger desk than me or whatever, you know, that is more like a grievance or a complaint. And it should really be dealt with internally by middle management. However, if it's about quality and it's about the quality of the service, that really should go to the board subcommittee that is responsible for overseeing quality. In this case, I'm thinking of staff governance, because every board is a staff governance subcommittee. And that subcommittee has got non-executive members on it. And those people are appointed to oversee how the health board is working. And they don't get the knowledge. I mean, the whistleblowing champions come from within that group, but they don't have the knowledge because there's no mechanism for them to find out how much whistleblowing is going on. So they can't act as a champion.
Thanks very much. I think you've clarified for me the difference between a hotline and a helpline, so I'll just ask Maurice Corey to ask a question.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Mr. Gregson, can I ask, the first line of the background information states that the hotline will build upon existing whistleblowing policies. Can you clarify your view of policies such as the staff governance standard and the partnership information network?
Well, I don't, all I know about the partnership arrangement is that there's a group that involves the unions and NHS management in jointly overseeing the health service in Scotland, and that is the partnership arrangement. I know what the NHS whistleblowing policies look like, and I can tell you that those policies that are given to staff don't have any indication that there's an individual person or champion to whom concerns can be brought. It does mention the National Confidential Alert Line, which is the helpline that I told you about, but that isn't... I mean, last year, Paul Gray wrote to all the health boards in September, and this is the letter, with a number of things that he wanted health boards to do. That was in September. This is a year later. If you examine the minutes for the 14 territorial health boards in Scotland, you'll find that none of this has been done. Well, they have appointed the champions, but nothing else, and those champions' identities are kept secret. So how can they champion anything? I mean, my definition of champion isn't that it's a person that nobody knows of. So the things that Paul Gray, and I can actually go through them if you like, and I can point to the things that aren't happening. And one of the things he suggested is that there's a named contact for whistleblowing, and that doesn't exist. So I can't completely answer your question because I don't know enough, but I do know that what the government thinks happening is not what's happening.
Yes, I was going to ask you about the National Confidential Alert Line and whether you think it's been assessed as operating effectively. You've pretty much answered that in your opening statement. I am taking it that you don't think it's operating effectively.
Well, when I was at the council, the first thing the council wanted to do, because I lodged a petition to the Petitions Committee at the council 3 years ago, and the Petitions Committee went off and said, oh yes, we'll look at this. And the corporate management team came back and they said, okay, we want to set up a helpline, public concern at work to run a helpline. And that was at the same time, that was in May 2013, that there was a conference here in Edinburgh by Scotland Patients Association, where they identified with Dr. Kim Holt from Patients First that the helpline wasn't working. And that was 3 years ago, and things haven't got any better since. And I campaigned hard at that point for the council not to have a helpline, and it took a lot of work. It was only because the Evening News got involved and a lot of people wrote to their councillor saying, we don't want a helpline, we want a staff hotline. And that was why the council in the end agreed to change it. And it's about risk. This whole thing's about the management of risk. How do you effectively manage risk? And I actually finally had a meeting with the head of legal at Edinburgh Council and convinced him that this was about the management of risk, and he saw the light. And the next thing was that he'd agreed that the risk committee at the council could take reports. And then that was a year and a half later, the council's now published in January of this year a report saying how effective the hotline has been and how much it's improved efficiency. You know, no one's boasting that the helpline's done that at the NHS, but the council itself is now saying something that they initially opposed is now a huge boon.
This may be a simplistic question. If you can answer it just briefly, I'd appreciate it. When people phone the helpline, what do you think happens? You know, what's the outcome? If I wanted to lift the phone just now and phone the helpline, where does it go?
Well, the public concern at work run the helpline, so you'll get a call handler who knows what the NHS whistleblowing policy is because they've got it in front of them. And they'll guide the caller through it and advise them that the thing is best addressed internally by going back to their manager or going to the union. Now, 90% of callers, and this is all published because the helpline publishes its data on the Scottish Government website, 90% of callers have already been to their manager and been disappointed by the response, and yet the helpline just tells them to go back there again. Eventually, if things go very bad, the helpline will get involved in taking the case to Health Improvement Scotland, but there's only been 6 over the past 3 years.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Brian Whittle?
You described the difference between a helpline and a hotline, and your petition seems to suggest there's a lack of confidence in the helpline, whether that's in relation to confidentiality or outcomes. I just wonder why you think a hotline would make a difference in those levels of confidence.
Now, the hotline is a different beast entirely. When you phone up a hotline, the first question isn't, who are you? The first question is, which organisation do you work for? You know, they're concerned about the organisation. They will, after they have that knowledge, will then say, if you choose to, you can remain anonymous, but we will log your call. And they take written notes throughout the conversation of what their concern is. So at the end of that, they then say to the caller, we will give you a written report of your concern, and we will also take the same written report to the risk committee or whatever body's appointed to take the reports. So the whistleblower hasn't been pulled into the nightmare of dealing with middle management. The whistleblower has had the weight taken from their shoulders, and that has been given to the hotline, who have then committed to taking it to the risk committee, for example. And that's what's so utterly different, because that kind of experience actually means that whistleblowers aren't frightened of retribution, and they're not frightened of being ignored, because thereafter the hotline provider has a commitment to keeping the whistleblower informed on progress relating to their concern. Now, it's actually a commercial arrangement. These are commercial organisations. They only do this for money. However, they function very effectively in routing concerns and in managing risk. And that is why it's different, because you're having a single point of contact, a single number that anyone, and there's 160,000 workers at the NHS in Scotland, that single number would take that concern and route it to the relevant committee for them. So it takes the weight from their shoulders. They no longer have to carry the burden, the fear of retribution and victimisation.
Just in a simplistic way, why it seems to me what you're talking about is culture here and the way that potential complaints are being held. Why can't we adapt the helpline? Because what you seem to be suggesting is a completely new system. Can the helpline not be adapted towards what you're talking about?
The helpline is not set up to take reports. I mean, public concern at work, it's their sort of founding principle, is that they don't do that. They're not there to route concerns to the committee. And it's a different beast entirely. I mean, public concern work are a charity, fundamentally, whereas these hotlines are commercial businesses. I would posit that if you think you need to change it, you need to re-tender, because you probably get a better price. I think there's commercial competition. There's a number of hotline providers in Britain. The one that I know most about does Edinburgh Council and it does three health trusts in England. And those health trusts use it because it allows staff to route concerns directly to the whistleblowing champion or to the relevant committee. So it's a different beast. You know, they have a different service, a different way of operating, and they work in a different way because they're set up to log reports and to take reports to committees.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you very much, Mr. Gregson. We now would want to consider and discuss what action we might want to take in this petition. We have got some suggestions identified already. I wonder if members have any comments on what we might, how we might want to progress this petition.
I would quite like to understand how the hotlines that Mr. Gregson is talking about are actually functioning from their perspective. I don't know how easy that would be to do.
Well, right to Edinburgh City Council and to Salford Royal NHS Foundation. They have got hotlines and see how they, what their view is, what their purpose is, and maybe some of the challenges that they face as well.
The University Hospital of South Manchester, and there's Camden and Islington Foundation Trust. I only found out about these yesterday. So there's three trusts in all that I would suggest have a view that might be helpful.
Okay, we could maybe establish how long the hotline's been working in these other places. Whether I think that the Salford Royal one is one that's already been identified as perhaps working, and it would be a good starting point for us anyway. Anything else?
Yeah, can I also suggest, Chair, that we ought to seek the progress, Scottish Government's view on the progress in relation to the introduction of the non-exec whistleblowing champions. Let's see where we are on that.
Okay. But it does seem, from the petitioner's point of view, a gap between what the Scottish Government thinks is happening and what the reality
that's
is.
The point.
So it would be worth establishing that. Do we want to write to anyone else?
The point of Mr. Gregson saying is we need to seek the views of the public concern at work, etc., NHS boards generally, while we're looking at it, unions and other any other stakeholders groups.
Can I request that you write to the whistleblowing champions that have been appointed? Because I know that the champions themselves have been appointed at each NHS trust, NHS board in Scotland, and ask them, ideally for a personal view, because they're there because they obviously care about the subject. If you're asking for a trust view, it's going to be quite different from their own reflections.
Quite like to do, in my view, we should write to the NHS boards first and identify what they, you know, they've appointed, what progress have they made, what's the purpose of these whistleblowing champions. I'm not sure if we should be seeking the personal views of these champions at this stage. And it certainly is not... if there are whistleblowing champions who would want to give evidence to the committee, they obviously have the opportunity to do that. But I think just at this stage, I think we would want to write to the NHS board. Is that agreed?
Is it all right for me to... Yes. I mean, I don't know if Sir Robert Francis might be pertinent. I mean, he was the one that the Scottish Government had said that they were going to follow his report. I mean, might he be able to comment?
Well, I think what we want to establish is whether, if there's a gap between what the Scottish Government thinks is happening and is actually happening, I think that's the first stage, and it may be once we have that information and we can reflect further on whether there is a gap between what the intention was and the reality, and it's certainly something that we can look at once that evidence has come in. Anything else? Angus?
Yeah, well, just to add, Convener, clearly depending on the responses that we do get back, I would be keen to seek the views of the Scottish Government at a later date, once we've reviewed what comes back, as to whether they'd consider commissioning an independent review into an open and honest reporting culture in the NHS. But that's for a later date.
I think let's take it first step. There is a suggestion, at the very least, the Scottish Government's intention and the reality are quite far apart. And we want to write to these other organisations of an interest. And I do think that may be, at that stage, you know, I think everyone is in favour of a culture where people feel safe to whistleblow, and we recognise the complexities of that. But that's something we want to look at further. If that's agreed, and with those recommendations, can I thank Mr. Gregson for attending today? It's a petition we'll be coming back to. and can we suspend while we change witnesses? Thank you. recommence. We're now going to deal with petition P1605, oh, beg your pardon, 1603 on ensuring greater scrutiny, guidance and consultation on armed forces visits to schools in Scotland. This petition has been lodged on behalf of Quakers in Scotland and Forces Watch, from whom we will take evidence today. Can I welcome to the meeting Mary Campbell-Jack from Quakers in Scotland? I understand there are two witnesses from Forces Watch are en route, so I'm happy that if we can start with you, given the time constraints, and if your colleagues arrive in time, then they obviously can join us. Can I invite you to make a short opening statement, if you wish, and then we'll move to questions from members. And again, it would be helpful if both questions and answers could be as succinct as possible.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener, and I do apologise for the lateness of my colleagues. I believe they've had some traffic trouble.
I think they've just arrived.
Oh, hello!
Can I welcome Emma Sangster from Forces Watch and Rihanna Louise from Forces Watch to join Mary Campbell-Jack in presenting this petition? And can I ask Mary Campbell-Jack to make an opening statement?
Okay, thank you, Convener. I'm representing Quakers in Scotland today. Quakers formed in 1652, so we've been around for almost 400 years. At a very early stage, the peace testimony of Quakers became a very important central part of their belief, and for many Quakers today, it's still a strong part of their identity. The peace testimony has seen Quakers working in battlefields and conflict zones across centuries and around the globe, tending to the injured, comforting the dying, and brokering peace. In the modern day, we've worked in places like Rwanda on truth and reconciliation, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and in elections in Burundi to make sure they are held free and fairly. The peace testimony is not just people sitting in the warmth and comfort of their own homes wishing for a better world, but Quakers go out and actually live their peace testimony, sometimes putting their own safety and lives at risk. Quakers in Scotland are concerned at an increasing militarisation in society since the Iraq War, and we are especially concerned when it comes to the militarisation of our young people in schools. We believe that there are several issues here. One is child welfare. There's increasing evidence that the younger somebody joins the armed forces, the worse their outcomes are, including death, disability, addiction, and poor mental health. There's a concern around informed choice, as it appears that often when the armed forces go into schools, there is not adequate balance. They are presenting a glossy, glamorised and adventurous image of life in the armed forces, and it does not take into account the uniqueness of this career, the dangers and the ethical problems that soldiers and other people in the armed forces may be faced with. The last concern we have here is about parental choice. It appears that not all parents are informed by the armed forces or the school of their visits, so they don't have an opportunity to discuss the visit with their child, with the school, or with the teacher concerned, and therefore their right to conscientiously object is removed. In this petition, we're asking for scrutiny, to have transparent, accessible information available to the public, guidance so that teachers and parents know how balance is achieved in the classroom, and consultation so that parents and children themselves can consider and have a voice on this issue.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to questions. Can I ask just first of all, on the point you make about parental choice, would you see in senior levels of school that that choice should be exercised by the student rather than the parent?
Well, we would expect students and parents to talk with each other about this and talk about the issues. How parents and students want to have that conversation in their own home isn't up to us, but we would hope that as children got older, they would be able to start their own process of critical thinking about these issues.
What I'm trying to establish, if somebody's over 16 and isn't able to vote, should it not be within their right to determine whether they access, you know, should the issue be that they have the right to withdraw from an event in school where the army is present rather than, or the armed forces, rather than it being a decision for their parent?
I would agree with that statement.
Okay. Can I also ask you, the petition refers to a narrow definition of recruitment being used by the armed forces in that it only refers to the act of signing up. How would you define recruitment, and would that definition apply to other organisations? Do you think should all careers-related activities in schools that promote particular careers or organisations, should that be considered to be recruitment as well?
Well, we see recruitment, like many things in Scotland, as a process rather than event, and we know that the armed forces see it as a process as well from their documents. Would you like to say some more, Emma?
Yes, I mean, we know from their internal documents that that they see recruitment as taking, you know, the sort of pre-recruitment interest that they would like to gaining young people, that would take place over a number of years and might be sparked by any one sort of encounter with the armed forces. And when, of course, we do accept that the actual process of recruitment, of signing up on the dotted line, as it were, doesn't actually take place in the school. And in any case, it would need to involve parents at that final stage. But we're concerned that a lot of what happens in schools is that sort of pre-recruitment activity. And there's certainly quite a bit of evidence from within internal MOD documents that that's how it's also viewed by them.
Regard that as a process that other organisations also go through when they go into schools?
I think that's an area that we're not expert on in terms of how other organisations might, what they might seek to get out of their activities in schools. But we do know, we have done some research on other public service visits to schools, and none of the data that we found showed anything like the level of visits that the armed forces make to schools. The fire service go into schools, but that's to talk about fire safety. That's not particularly to talk about becoming part of the fire service.
Private companies are going in to recruit. Would you expect there to be some kind of monitoring of what those jobs
indeed
involve, whether there's ethical questions in their work too?
Yes, indeed, of course. I mean, I don't think the education system should be seen as a sort of ready catchment for recruits into any industry, really, because, so, you know, going down any pathway needs a lot of consideration. Of course, it might be an arena where you'd start to gather information about different career pathways, but not to go, you know, a significant way down any of those pathways.
So you would be concerned more generally about career fairs going on in schools where companies come in and talk about what they do?
Well, I think a lot of those are about sort of opening up options to young people. I think the armed forces are a little bit different because you can sign up at age 16 and you can commit yourself to a long period of service, up to 6 years. And that's actually quite different from any other career. So, and of course, you've got the unique risks of an armed forces career. And so it does need extra consideration. And that's one of the things that the Welsh Government in particularly noted, that it's that unique nature of an armed forces career that sets it aside from other employers in this respect.
Okay, thanks very much. Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, convener. Good morning, everyone. I note that you're concerned that schools in deprived areas have been targeted, although you say that there is not a straightforward link between the number of visits and levels of deprivation. Now, in relation to the number of visits to schools, the petition states 83% of secondary schools have been visited compared to 50% of independent secondary schools. And for state schools, a total number of visits is also provided. Do you have a total number of visits to independent schools? Independent secondary schools?
We do have that figure. I don't have it totally to hand at the moment. It was clear from the data set that we were looking at for that report that the visits to independent schools really were just a fraction of total visits overall, and far fewer of those schools were visited. In fact, the Army, in those 2 years, we didn't have a single recorded visit by the Army to an independent school. They were all from the RAF or the Navy. and the army just visited state secondary schools.
Okay, if you do have that breakdown,
I can provide you with that.
Figures,
yes.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay, Maurice Corey.
Can I just declare, Kavina, that I had a visit from Mr. Jim Wyke, an independent researcher on this subject, to my office. Just want to make sure that we're clear on that. Can I ask, Mrs. Campbell-Jack, the location of Armed Forces Careers Office is significant, and could you expand on that and say something about how that significance is demonstrated by evidence of career-related activities in schools?
Sorry, could you just repeat the first part of that sentence?
Yeah, the location of the Armed Forces Careers Offices is significant.
Oh, I actually think Forces Watch would be better at answering this question. Right. They'll be able to give you more information.
Yes, it was linked to the issue of whether more visits are made to certain areas, and we did find that certain local authority areas were visited more than others. If you look at the range of visits geographically, there is a focus in the sort of central belt going up towards towards Aberdeen, and that is where a lot of the Armed Forces Careers Offices were certainly located at the time that of the data that we were looking at. So I think it's one of the location of those offices, where regiments are based, where there might be a lot of armed forces families living, where there might be other employment related to the armed forces. I think these are all factors that are important in looking at how which schools are visited more than others. And I think perhaps one very significant factor is the relationship that the school has built up with the armed forces, or the armed forces has built up with the school over time, and that will enable more visits to take place.
Can I just further that, Chair? Have you considered the fact that in Scotland is unique in many ways for its regimental traditions, mm-hmm. and in fact the regimental families, and if you go to many parts of Scotland there are unique ties with those local regiments, mm-hmm. which is something more so than the rest of the UK. Have you considered that, and have you not built that into some of your research?
Well, yes, we do understand that that is, you know, very particular to Scotland, and but I don't think it undermines the concerns that we have in terms of how visits should be conducted and what guidance should be given to schools around those visits.
I'm just thinking of the interest point of view of the families involved, who those children who come forward to cite to declare an interest in maybe being recruited. Therefore, there is an external interest, we'll call it, okay, which I think is very important for you to consider. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
In terms of visits to schools, has a comparison been made with any other employee, be it the public or private sector, or with other uniformed services, such as the police or the fire service or the ambulance service?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch the beginning of that question.
Has there been a comparison made with any other of the employees?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, we did try and get data through Freedom of Information about the number of visits from other public services. And there was the armed forces do visit schools at significantly higher rate. But we haven't done a huge amount of research into further into that area, really. But we just wanted to explore whether other public services are visiting schools to that degree, and we think that we can say confidently they're not, and I actually don't think they're resourced in the same way that would allow them to visit at that level, because, you know, the armed forces do put quite a bit of funding in that direction.
We would also argue that comparing other public sector employers with the armed forces isn't actually comparing like with like, because one of our points is that this is a very unique job. It's unique in its dangers and it's unique in the ethical questions around it. And while there are other jobs that are dangerous, say being a fireman or being a paramedic, where you are putting yourself at risk and going into risky situations, these are jobs you can also quit quite easily, whereas it's not the same for the army. And we think that it needs to be treated differently from other employers and its uniqueness should be recognised.
Okay, so can I just, is there any evidence, including from elsewhere in the UK, that visits to schools have a tangible impact on numbers of young people joining the armed forces? Or is the information gathering suggested by the petition part of being able to make that assessment?
We don't have particular information on... you know, within a school, if a school's visited regularly, whether those young people might go on to join. I mean, we do know that over 2,500 under 18-year-olds join the armed forces currently annually. So those that will have been precipitated by the armed forces, you know, having contact with those young people at some point. But yeah, we haven't actually looked at that direct relationship. Obviously, perhaps not so much in Scotland, but elsewhere in the UK, you've got the cadet forces in schools, and that's something that's being expanded, particularly in England and Wales. And that is perhaps more of a direct link between, you know, involvement in cadets and then taking going on to join the armed forces.
We started doing the research for this petition in early 2015 and gathering up FOIs, but we actually found it incredibly difficult to get hold of information. Some of the information where the armed forces had recorded their visits to school was on handwritten notes. Other times personnel had changed or left the armed forces and they couldn't get the information from what they'd done, or I think in one point there was a computer system change. So there was massive holes in the information we could get. So it's very hard for people to actually have really reliable data and information on what's happening in schools, and that's one of the reasons why we do believe we need accessible information that the public can look up.
Yes, I would reiterate that, having done a lot of the data analysis myself, and the difficulties of using the data, of getting hold of the data and then using it. And that's one of the issues that we think it's very important to address. And I think there's another element that is more recent, which we don't have much information on, but we think it needs exploring, which is the involvement of Capita, which is the private company that has the recruitment contract with the MOD. And part of that involves working within education to interest young people in enlisting in the armed forces. Now, we don't know the extent to which Capita as a or the outreach team in Capita actually visit schools. But obviously, if they are visiting schools, then their single remit is to provide recruits in the longer term. Whereas you could say that the armed forces have a number of interests in going into schools, partly to inform young people about what they do and to create, you know, general... more knowledge within young people, but as well as recruitment. But Capita's sole interest will be to recruit. So we think that there should be research done and more transparency around the role of Capita in this process.
Okay, thank
you. Rona McKay.
Yes, your petition talks about a need for a balanced view to be presented by the armed forces. What do you think the chances of that happening? Do you think that will be forthcoming?
Well,
Well, there is some questions around balance and where it is appropriate to come from. It could be that the teacher in the classroom might be the best person to provide balance after the visit for the students. It could be that the school might choose to provide balance by having some peace organisations come in and also talk to children. There's some great organisations out there like Veterans for Peace and Peace Jam. So those are two ways of providing balance. The other concern is not so much what the teachers and schools are doing, but that the presentation the armed forces give, it does seem to be quite glossy and glamorous and exciting. And we do know that young people's cognitive development means they're not as good as assessing long-term risk to themselves as people who are older would be. And so there's a risk with the armed forces creating a rather rose-tinted view of what the life's actually like. And then there's also the issue of who's best to provide balance and how organisations like Quakers in Scotland can support schools and teachers and local authorities in providing that balance.
Essentially, you're saying that they're not giving a balanced view when they do their presentations.
We do not believe so.
Yeah. Just a wee follow-up from that, if I can. What are the views of the... Do you know what the views of the pupils are when they have these presentations and when the...
Well, I think probably like most of Scotland, it will be very mixed. Yeah. Some people will probably welcome it. Some people might feel very neutral. We do know from Quaker children that they've been left to feel very uncomfortable in the classroom. Sometimes they've not been given any alternative but to attend. And that's been very difficult for them. So it would be great to have the plurality of views recognised.
Thank you.
Can I just maybe ask... I mean, it seems to me you were posing, in terms of balance, the implication was that the armed forces were in favour of war and our peace organisations were in favour of peace.
Actually, peace organisations aren't necessarily in favour of peace. They're in favour of critical thinking around conflict issues and would work with children to encourage that critical thinking. We feel that criticism does not come when it's just an armed forces visit.
If the armed forces were talking, for example, about peacekeeping work through the United Nations, presumably they themselves are also not seen through one prism.
We're not aware of any armed forces visits where they've focused on peacekeeping work.
If I could just add to that, I think besides peacekeeping, there's also peace building and conflict transformation, and there's a whole realm of material out there about conflict transformation which isn't widely available to children in schools. And if the armed forces is going to go in and talk about military responses to conflict, then I think that they should be made aware that there are other responses and diplomacy is also an option. And I think when you actually look at what's the information that's given to young people, even on the Armed Forces website, it doesn't actually talk about conflict very much at all. It talks about other things like skills development, and it talks about scuba diving and exciting kind of sports activities. The actual combat is really not mentioned at all. So I think it's misleading to think that the armed forces actually talk about conflict itself very much when they go into schools.
Uh-huh. I mean, with education as a precursor to a career path, and I think a simple question really is that do you oppose that joining the armed forces is a reputable career path to go down?
We oppose the fact that children are recruited into our armed forces.
Define a 16-year-old as a child?
Well, legally, anyone under 18 is a child.
But we have moved to a point where I think 16-year-olds are now recognised as young adults who have a vote.
Yeah, they do, and I personally welcome the fact that young people are being more and more involved in public life, but the transition from childhood to adulthood doesn't just happen on your birthday. It's a very, very slow process, and we think the last part of that process should be choosing a job where you may end up either dying yourself or taking the life of another person, the impact of which should not be underestimated.
Can I ask finally who you would see as being responsible for overseeing the collection of data and ensuring its rigour in terms of actually understanding what's happening in our schools, and how was this question addressed in Wales?
That is a really good question, because obviously schools and local authorities are under a lot of pressure, and teachers in the classroom are under a lot of stress as well. We don't necessarily understand the way each individual local authority works and how this could fit in with individual local authorities, which is one of the reasons why we'd welcome an inquiry to have the chance to open up discussion and debate around that issue.
Another question, sure. Right. Yes, Mr. Campbell, you talked about Capita as being a recruitment organisation for the armed forces. Have you got any research information from them as to the visits that you talked about, bits of paper being written on by the army itself? But surely if Capita are the ones recruitment, surely you've got information from them?
Over to Emma for that one.
Well, as a private company, they are not covered by freedom of information legislation, so it's actually even more difficult to get information about how they're conducting their contract with the MOD. So,
have you actually spoken to them?
We have. The information we have is via the MOD about...
No, have you spoken to Capita?
No, we haven't directly spoken to them, but it's something that we would like to pursue.
So that's where the information will be?
We hope, but it would be very helpful for an inquiry of, by the Scottish Parliament would open the doors, I think, for that information to be forthcoming.
As a follow-up, Chair, to that question... you talk about, obviously, the armed forces visits, but remember there are also defence manufacturers like British Aerospace. We're looking for modern apprenticeships. There's Lockheed Martin. There's various other organisations who do visit schools. Have you researched into that, the frequency of their visits to schools?
We focus particularly on the armed forces. We're aware that there are sort of developing relationships between education and industry of that kind, particularly for older children in the education system. Some of those things are very new, and we're looking at them, but we haven't actually done substantial research on that.
Yeah, would you not agree it's something you should look at?
Yes, I mean, we are looking at it, particularly within England, the university technical colleges, which are really founded on partnerships with local industry, and some of that does include the defence industry and the armed forces within an area. So we are looking at that right at this moment, yes.
Would you say your case is rather narrow at the moment and not really broadened to, it's just concentrating on the uniformed element of it?
Yes, it is. And part of the reason is that we are very small organisations who only have part-time staff. We don't have the kind of budget that people like MOD or Lockheed Martin have to put resources into this. It's taken us a year and a half of work to get here. So there's lots of things we would really love to be able to do, but unfortunately resources and time doesn't always make that possible for us.
Thank you, Chair.
Any other questions? No, in that case, can I thank you very much for your evidence? I think there's an awful lot of stuff there. If I can characterise it, we can have a think about what we want to do. There has been a long-held concern that possibly, for example, poverty is the greatest recruiting sergeant to the army, and we would be very concerned if communities were targeted in that kind of way. But my sense is that what you're looking for is some transparency around actually what is happening and what are the protections. And was it a more general issue about when private companies or whoever go into our schools, we want to know that they're not promising the earth and, encouraging people perhaps to make choices but that are not fully informed. So I think it is an interesting area to try and get some more information on. I don't know whether members have a view.
I think that I don't know what the modern army recruitment process is. When a young man or woman walks through the door to look to join the army, I don't know what that process is, and I'd like to understand that a bit better. And I'm all under the auspices that there is a general reduction in the number of armed forces in the country as well. So I don't. All I'm saying is I'm unaware of how many knock on the door and how many get accepted and what the process is. I would like to know that.
Any other suggestions?
Just, I think in the case of my own local authority, it went to a vote at council, this issue, and the council took the decision not to allow it. And I know that local authorities do seem to have some autonomy in this matter. Have you gone down the route of, you know, going round local authorities and asking if...
Yeah. We have. We in fact, contacted every local authority in Scotland, and we got responses from... 26. About 26 of them, yes. Yeah. So, but that information showed quite a varying picture, with some not really kind of particularly recognising the issues, while others had done more to give guidance to schools. But really, a very ununiform approach, and not. A lot of local authorities saying, well, actually, we leave it up to head teachers to decide. And
passing what was going on there.
Yeah, or lack of clarity about where the responsibility for this actually lies. Because it also covered by sort of the careers service side of things, as well as education. So there's a lot of different agencies that could be involved, but where does responsibility actually lie?
Okay. So I suppose one of the things we would be interested in knowing, perhaps from the Scottish Government, what their view is from the local authorities. You know, I can see in some localities with a strong connection to the army, individual schools might be very keen on this. In other areas, there's less of a connection. Is there a role? So I mean, would it be contacting local authorities, or maybe just COSLA at this stage, and ask what their view is? And Scottish Government, obviously, we'd want to contact the Army in terms of their career service, what their response is to petition. Yeah. Any other suggestions?
Definitely,
you could widen it to parent councils, etc., but maybe that's for further down the line. Mm. Maybe the initial stages, it needs to be the government and the local authorities through COSLA.
Okay. Yeah. Skills Development Scotland, because obviously they develop the careers kind of approach to schools.
School decides, you know, what presentations from which organisations, how they make that decision. Mm-hmm. So I mean, and who would that be? Would, you know, Education Institute, I don't know, secondary teachers, secondary teachers association.
Sure whether the unions would have a view at this stage, or can I suggest that there is a series of organisations, and one suggestion has been including the Children and Young People's Commissioner and Scottish Youth Parliament, who may have a view in this. But that's a list that perhaps in consultation with the clerks we can expand, because we're really just trying to get the information, get a sense of where people are in this as a kind of that dilemma between, on the one hand, particular communities being targeted, but also recognising that for some young people there's potentially some good employment outcomes. You know, and we've seen that in terms of some young people making that active choice to go into the armed forces, but we do to get a sense of what that looks at, what the safeguards are, and, you know, the extent to which it's not being targeted in particular communities. Would that be fair? Are we agreed on that then?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, can I thank you very much for your attendance? We will await the responses to the correspondence we have, and we'll keep you in touch with how that has then progressed afterwards.
Thank
okay.
You very much
and
for your time.
Thank you. And can we suspend while we move to the next petition? recommence this meeting of the Petitions Committee. We're now going to deal with petition 1604 on inquest for all deaths by suicide in Scotland. The final petition we will consider today has been lodged by Catherine Matheson, from whom we will take evidence. She's accompanied by her daughter. And can I thank you both for being here today, and I welcome you to the meeting. It's Catherine Matheson and Karen Gordon. And if I can ask Catherine maybe to make a short opening statement, if you wish.
The reason we're here today is that we don't believe that the current system is serving the best interests for relatives of those who die by suicide in the community under community compulsory treatment orders. The fatal accident inquiry system was reviewed last year, and in our opinion, a valuable opportunity was lost where all these deaths could have been covered, you know, deaths under NHS care by suicide under these orders in the community could have been covered by that review, but they weren't, although deaths in the prison system were. So now all deaths in the prison system will be mandatory to go to a fatal accident inquiry. But if you're out in the community and you die by suicide, it's really up to the NHS how they investigate the way you died and the circumstances leading up to that. I'll give you a bit of personal background if I can. My son was ill for many years with schizophrenia. His final hospital admission was from March 2010 to April 2012. While he was in hospital, his illness took a severe turn where, you know, he did things he hadn't been doing before, trying to severely damage himself all the time. For a whole year, we were told he's not suicidal. He wrote final notes to us while he was in the hospital at that time. We were given to them by the Procurator Fiscal 6 months after he died, when she found them in his files. And this consultant was saying, your son's not suicidal. Eventually, we complained. We said, look, this can't go on, you know. Son's harming himself, swallowing objects. He was referred for surgery twice to have objects removed. Still told he wasn't suicidal. And the consultant was then allowed to handle the complaint against him when we wrote to complain. He wrote back to me. He said perfectly sane people do these things. So eventually after this year, my son was sectioned and transferred to Carsview, where I discovered that his medical records were totally incorrect. I corrected the records. I was told the corrections would stay with his records. That didn't happen. Eventually, he was released on a compulsory community treatment order. He was cancelling numerous appointments that we didn't know about. One of the reasons that he was on that order was to make sure he engaged with the services so that they could make sure he was staying well and safe in the community. But despite cancelling these appointments and being anxious in the weeks leading up to his death, no one took any notice. No one did anything. On the day that he died, he cancelled an appointment by answering machine to the Scottish Association of Mental Health, who were supporting him. They reported it to his psychiatric nurse, who did nothing again. I got home at 10 to 5 and found him hanging from his loft. Now, on that day too, he had been to his GP practice. His prescription for a drug called ephenadrine that was to stop his anxiety and restlessness in his limbs was not available, as he'd been promised the day before it would be. And what I'm trying to do with this is to build you a picture of how various elements were involved in the lead up to my son's death by suicide. And none of these elements have been satisfactorily examined for the sake of improving the system. Nothing I do or say will bring my son back, or my daughter's brother, or my grandson's dad. Won't bring him back. But the fact is that if we can get this system properly a process that can properly investigate these things that are going wrong, that's the only way we can improve that system. NHS Tayside can decide for themselves what kind of reports they do. They did a SCEA report initially. They didn't involve us in it. They didn't involve the GP practice in it. They didn't involve the mental health officer in it. In the first instance, I had to contact them and ask them what they would do, and they didn't have any standard procedures in place. When my son died, the Procurator Fiscal sent me a letter saying, "We are very sorry to hear of the death of your son. This is what will now happen." The NHS had nothing like that, and when I asked them about it, they said they had to update their DATEX system or some such thing. So they did a report that covered the last 6 months of my son's life. They didn't include the other 2 years where he was in hospital, because it was kind of the same thing, where he was in hospital but out of hospital on leave. He was still under their care for 2.5 years. They said they would do it, and I was advised by the patient association, because of the length of time they were taking, to talk to a solicitor. I talked to a solicitor who got me a report by an independent expert, and the NHS said, "Well, now you've talked to a solicitor, we're not doing any report on your son's death. You know, we're finished here." Now, you might say, "Well, okay, fair enough, you know, you went to a solicitor," but when we got the independent report, that was all we wanted. Our legal action stopped there. We couldn't afford to go any further. We didn't want any more. Just somebody to tell us whether what had happened, well, which we knew in my son's case, it wasn't right anyway, but we wanted a proper expert opinion. And having got that, the NHS were able to say, "Well, we're not doing this anymore, you know." Now, for their own purposes, they should be doing a complete report on anyone who dies by suicide in the community under their care, for their own purposes, so they can review their own systems and see what could they do better in the future, or what maybe, you know, shouldn't have happened, for their purposes, not just ours. So they had that within their power to say, "We'll do a report or we won't do a report." They did produce an independent report for the Procurator Fiscal, which in our opinion, and you've probably heard this before from many relatives of people who die by suicide, it was just an absolute whitewash. It listed all the appointments my son had cancelled and said, "Well, that's okay, you know, cancelled appointments, that's fine, you know, nothing they could have done." But, you know, the whole purpose of him being in that system was that there was something they could have done. They should have had him kind of reviewed and asked why he was cancelling appointments. Nothing of that happened. So my conclusion is that only a proper inquest type investigation will lead to all the facts being established, and if it's chaired by a truly independent body, perhaps such as the Mental Welfare Commission, it should lead to improvements in care and maybe even save lives, which is what we all want. I don't want anyone else to go through what our family has been through.
Thank you very much for that, and I do appreciate just how difficult it is when it is your own son that you're having to talk about. And I wanted to say on behalf of the committee, thank you very much for that opening statement, because I think the point you make, which is the most powerful one in terms of this committee, is that this is now about how we make sure it doesn't happen to someone else and what are the lessons from it. And there are systems that can be put in place to avoid this distress in the future. That would be, I think, a very important aim for the committee. Can I ask you, I mean, this is an issue that I wasn't aware of, but the distinction between your son's treatment in hospital and then in the community, do you think that was the thing that actually caused the problem? That was, there was a breakdown in communication, there wasn't the same close monitoring of how he was?
Well, I think there should have been closer monitoring, but after he died, I kind of pieced all the pieces of the jigsaw together, you know, what happened to him that day. And I found out about him not getting his prescription from the GP. I found out that he'd cancelled the appointment with Sam Itch. And when I spoke to Sam Itch, they said, "Well, we have a duty that when someone cancels an appointment with us, we have to let the CPN, the psychiatric nurse, know, or whoever's in charge of person's care." And CPN didn't seem to have that duty. There was no trigger where, you know, it would say, "Well, he's missed 3 appointments or 6 appointments. What, I mean, he missed loads of appointments, you know. But there was nothing to trigger that
response to say, right, okay, this is appointment number three. Samich has told us we will phone him and see. You know, just a 2-minute phone call. What's gone wrong with you today? Are you all right? You know?
Risk assessment when somebody moves from the hospital setting out into the community, although they're still under the care of the hospital, and are there, you know, procedures? Well, there is a procedure, obviously, from SAMH, but are there other procedures to monitor how somebody is in the community when they're still under the care of the hospital?
The psychiatric nurse was the lead person, and the way the system worked, it was more kind of a system rather than, you know, procedures, was that, you know, the people who were supporting my son would report to her. And when we did attend the meeting of the first skier, they contacted us after they'd done the first skier, and they said, oh, but, you know, the CPN's autonomous. And we said, no, she's not autonomous. She's leading a team that is supposed to be caring for this person. And the sad thing is that that woman was at my son's funeral and she was really upset. And, you know, had there been some procedure, it would have been better for staff, you know, to have this certain procedure set out where they agree, you know, if you miss 3 appointments, I'll call you in, or if you miss 3 appointments, I'll phone you up, or, you know. And she would have been safe in knowing that she had done everything she could.
So your view, I suppose, then, is of the purpose of the inquest would be to identify those kinds of issues that have caused a death, and then there can be lessons learned around in changing procedure.
I think it's rather more than issues that can cause a death. It's kind of how do you keep that person safer in the community, you know? Is it by procedures? And if you find, as we discovered when I researched this, that this has happened before and the NHS has been criticised by the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman for it, for not responding when someone cancelled appointments, then, you know, if that's happening, it's up to the NHS to look at why is this still happening. And if they're not willing to do that, then I think it needs to have an independent body involved who will be involved in even a meeting like this about someone's death, where the GP is there, the mental health officer's there, everybody involved with that patient is represented, to say, you know, honestly, what went wrong, what could we do better?
Thank you, Brian Whittle.
I guess, really, you know, that what we're looking for here is what you're hoping to achieve, what outcome you hope to achieve from this. And I think I would just like to clarify your position in that you're not specifically pointing the finger at NHS staff. It's more the procedures in which they sit in. Would that be correct?
That's correct.
So, and ultimately, then, is your goal to have that those procedures reviewed?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Thank you. And where there are not procedures, for procedures to be put in place.
Thank you.
Mackay?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, and please, if you can't answer this, please don't feel you have to. In your view, what's the difference between a fatal accident inquiry and, you know, an inquiry of this nature that you're wanting?
A fatal accident inquiry covers a wide scope, and I think it could be covered by someone's actions leading to the unfortunate death of another. And that's the way I view my son's suicide. You know, someone's actions or inactions have led to his death. So, you know, we'd have been quite, I don't know if satisfied is the word, but we'd have been a bit more appeased if we had a fatal accident inquiry where everybody, as I say, it's about a meeting where everybody involved is having to attend that meeting and see what went wrong, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, Maurice Corey.
Thanks, Jack. Yes, thank you for your information, Ms. Masson. You refer to the independent inquest system that you're calling for, and you know, how do you feel sort of family should be involved in that?
Mm-hmm. I feel that we should be invited along with everyone else to give our view of what happened. You know, I thought I was leaving my son safe that day. I thought he's got a meeting with the support worker at 11:30.
The last time he contacted me was 11:38, and that's the last anyone heard from him. He would have been at that meeting had he not cancelled it. So, you know, I want to be sure that people like me can go away for... I went away for one day, and I couldn't leave him in safe hands for one day. And I want to be sure that people can be assured that, yes, he is still not regarded as being well, but he's on this compulsory treatment order that makes sure that he's engaging with the services and they're engaging with him.
Did they have daily checkups on him or not?
It wasn't daily, but I was there, you know, and I was keeping a very close eye on him. That one day I couldn't be there, and they should have been there. It didn't happen.
Thank you.
Angus McDonald.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. The Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths Scotland Act 2016 was passed in the last session of Parliament. Now, you may or not be aware that there's three stages to each bill that's going through Parliament, and stage two is where amendments are put forward at the committee that's dealing with that actual bill. And then at stage three, it goes on to the whole Parliament, where every member has an opportunity to submit an amendment. Now, at stage two, amendments were proposed which would have required fatal accident inquiries to be held for deaths in mental health detention. And these amendments were overturned at stage three amidst concerns that such a system would distress family members and stigmatise those with mental health conditions. What's your view on that?
That's not a view that I've heard expressed by any family that's lost anyone to suicide, because anyone that loses someone to suicide, all they want is answers. They want answers, you know. And I think the only way they can get answers is by a system such as I propose, that, you know, everyone is sitting around the table. I think if relatives are going to be too distressed, there should perhaps have been an option to say you don't have to attend if you don't want to attend. But I think for not just because, bear in mind, this is not just for the relatives. This is to save lives of people who are committing suicide every day. You know, there's two a day in Scotland. I don't think that's decreased over the years. So, you know, it's not... I think that was not a valid reason to reject it at all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I ask you, I'm interested in this, what happened to you in relation, as soon as you went to the solicitor, the NHS stepped back. Yeah. Was there argument that because you were going down that route, there was a possibility you were going to end up in conflict with them over, I don't know, compensation or whatever? Did you get a sense that was the reason why they stepped back?
I think it possibly was, although that wasn't our intention, you know. All we wanted was answers and changes to procedures, and we started out thinking... I mean, I used to read the papers and think, oh, there's a family, they're 3 or 4 years down the line, they've still not got answers. And sadly, we found that this is the way it works. You go to the Procurator Fiscal, the NHS really dragged their heels with her as well. She had to keep emailing them... You know, and time dragged on and on and on, nothing was happening. So I went to the Scottish Patients Association. They actually put me in touch with the solicitor that was recommended by them, because, as I say, all we wanted was answers and improvements. So now we've ended up that it will be 4 years in November since my son died. We were told earlier this year that we won't be getting a fatal accident inquiry. So, you know, I think that actually to have the kind of system that I would like would mean that this could all be done very quickly for the NHS as well, and it should be, because as time goes on, people change jobs, people move on who were actually involved, and although it's not about blaming staff, it's about passing on lessons learned, you know. And it's, you know, it's a bit like you have all new people sitting there thinking, well, I don't even know about this case, I didn't know this person. You know, I think it would be better if it was all sorted out nearer the time, within, say, a six-month period even, to have a meeting where it's all facts are established and any improvements that can be made are made.
Thank you. in terms of the outcomes of that meeting, mm-hmm. you would be looking to maybe recommendations around good practice. Would you see it as identifying staff members who had failed in their duty?
I think staff members should be given evidence, but I don't think there should be a culture of blame. I think they should have to be there to give evidence of what actually happened, but there should not be a blaming culture. If there are procedures missing, then you can't really say to a staff member, well, you didn't do that, because a staff member would be thinking, well, I wasn't told that I should be doing that, you know, which is a valid defence. So I don't think it's about blaming. I think it's about learning.
Thank you very much. Are there any other questions?
No. Can I go back to my original question, just with regard to the amendments that were put forward at stage two and were overturned at stage three, were any of these amendments, are you aware of any of these amendments being put forward as a result of your specific case? Or?
I wasn't aware. I was dealing with Christian Allard at the time, and he yeah. certainly didn't say to me whether any of these were put through on my behalf.
Okay, thanks.
Can I just make one more point, though?
Sure.
I'd like to come back to about the convener's last comment about recommendations. The information we found from the information that we found from the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman that this had happened already, you know, before. The NHS had had recommendations made about people in the community cancelling appointments, and they obviously haven't acted on these. I think we need something that is mandatory, and that's why I would like an independent person to chair any meeting that investigates the suicide of people under the mental health care system. It needs to be mandatory. They need to be time limited, and you know, you must show us that you have procedures in place by a certain date or whatever, because they can just please themselves at the moment. They can choose when they're going to do something or if they're going to do it, and I don't think that's good enough.
Okay. Thank you very much for that, and again, I appreciate taking the time and giving us so many things to think about. I think that's very challenging issues there, and a whole range of issues there, then I think my sense is the committee really would want to do something more about this. I mean, I don't know what kind of suggestions people have.
I mean, it's massively complex with a whole series of people involved in the ultimate tragedy. And I think, for me, I need to get an understanding of from the trust perspective of what procedures they would have in place. You know, when a tragic suicide case like this happens, what do they have in place? What would they usually do? What would their process be? And then you've got to talk to people like Sam H as well. I would imagine that I would like to understand from their perspective. You know, where are the warning signs from their perspective? What do they then do? And how do they then follow that up? But there's so many sort of moving parts within this to try and pick it apart.
Convener, I, you know, agree with my colleague. I think we need to find out what uniformity there is through health boards and how they deal with these situations. We need to get guidance, ask the Scottish Government, you know, what they know is in place to deal with this, and if they're aware of the irregularity of this and how this has been handled. I think, you know, virtually entirely this whole case has to be relayed to them so that they know exactly what we're talking about here, because it is extremely serious.
So I agree with my colleague on that, Jim.
I think, to me, there are two different things. There is, how did you end up in the position where your son was left up, you know, nobody was checking up that he had cancelled appointments, and on the particular day he was left, and what were the things that led to that, and what would, you know, what is the view of the Scottish Government health boards about how you'd address that very particular question about somebody who's in the care of a hospital but is out in the community, what the protections are. I think it's a separate issue, which again I think you have described in a very moving way, which is, once it's happened, what support is offered to the family to identify that actually it's been taken seriously and lessons learned from it. And I have dealt with cases in the past where the fatal accident inquiry system is not used in a lot of cases, and it's quite cumbersome, and it takes a long time. Is there something, as you suggest, that's a kind of a quicker process, but has the same force in terms of people listening? And I think the other element to it is the way in which, because you can't get an inquiry, families are forced into taking legal advice, and as soon as they do that, they become almost a problem for the health board that's to be resisted rather than to be worked with. And I think these are big, big issues that would be really, really useful for us to explore. I think in summary, I think we want to write to Scottish Government and their reaction to it. It may be that we also, you know, both to the health and to justice in terms of the question of access to justice in these circumstances. Is there anybody else we would want to speak to? It might be worth speaking to, as was suggested, Sam H, and perhaps get a perspective from the Scottish Patients Association, if we've not already got that, in terms of their view of how people can be supported through this process. Because it does feel to me a lot of barriers put in your place, and it's only your own strength of character and your determination that's taken you. And there are families like you, I know, in the constituency I represent, who have had to do the same kind of thing. Is there anything else you'd like to add before we conclude?
I guess the one thing that stood out for me in my brother's situation, all that time he was in hospital, he was constantly trying to commit suicide, and I think the hospital and NHS just failed to recognise that. They denied that kind of continuously throughout his care. Even though, like my mum said, he'd been swallowing objects, he'd been swallowing glass, cutlery, all this kind of stuff, anything he could get his hands on in the hospital. He had to have stuff removed from him. He was trying to hang himself with stuff in the actual hospital. But still, there was an overall sort of denial that he was actually trying to commit suicide. I think the hospital looked upon it that he was just self-harming. But I mean, to us, he was serious about this, and you know, it's proven now, looking back in hindsight, that that's what he was trying to do. So I think that failure, you know, I don't know if that had any sort of contribution to the care once he was out in the community. If the hospital just kind of thought, well, he's okay, he's not suicidal or anything, we don't have to follow up on appointments with him or whatever, you know, he's fine, we'll just put him out there.
That simple presumption or assumption or clinical diagnosis that he wasn't suicidal then led to other consequences. Do you think there is an issue about families being listened to in a hospital setting then? But you would probably understand and know him better than anybody else.
Definitely.
As well, he was in the hospital for 2 years, and then all of a sudden, over a period of a few weeks, he was allowed visits out gradually, and then he was released out, and that was it. You know, someone would make an appointment to go and see him every few weeks, and like that, he could reject that appointment at his own will, and nothing was followed up on it. So I think, and there wasn't any real process in when he was released from the hospital and engaging with the family and, you know, discussing maybe signs that we could look out for him being suicidal or, you know, stuff like that. And I think, I don't know if they do that when they actually are recognising that someone's suicidal or if that person should be released from the hospital or...
Rona?
Can I just ask you to confirm, how often did the hospital consult with you as a family or discuss your brother's situation with you, approximately?
Well, I consulted with them more than they would be willing to consult with me, you know, because I made sure that I became his named person and, you know, that I got as much information as I could. But, you know, I have heard other parents say we don't get told anything and, you know, but I think it was because of me and my
persistence. Did you instigate the meeting or did they come to you and say we'd like to discuss?
I think I did. Sometimes I did get invited to meetings and sometimes I didn't. Mm-hmm. And that was just the way it was. As I say, there doesn't seem to be anything mandatory about it. You know, it's all what the NHS decides they will do or will not do.
And you presumably at these meetings, you would have expressed your view that you thought maybe, you know, that he was suicidal.
Mm-hmm.
And do you feel you weren't being listened to at that point? Or?
We weren't being listened to. We got a letter saying that perfectly sane people do these things. They swallow broken glass, you know.
The work of the committee, we're obviously unable to pursue individual cases, but yeah. Your testimony is very powerful about what is happening in the system, and that's, you know, really important to us. So in terms of how we take it forward, it is very much, I think, what you said earlier on, you don't want anybody else to have to go through what you have done. So we would want to write to the Scottish Government, the Patients Association, Sam H, I think we said. Would it be there for we wait for those responses and then we can look further into this? I think this whole range of issues here. It may not be that actually your proposal in terms of how you solve the problem is the one eventually is fixed upon, but I think what you've done critically is to identify there is a big problem here and it's something that we would want to address, if that's agreed.
I'd say that's something that I think underpins the whole attitude of, oh, your son's not suicidal, although he's written final letters and he's obviously seriously damaging himself, is that I don't think there were any beds for him to be sectioned to.
Okay.
So I think that's important. You know, I can't believe, if there's a consultant who works in the NHS who sees all this happening, and there's a surgeon at Ninewell saying, I can't keep opening him up and stitching him up again, something will have to be done. I don't believe that consultant didn't think to himself, I would section him if there was a bed for him to go to, because beds are constantly being reduced and beds in Angus are currently under threat yet again, you know. I think there may have been, in my son's case, a shortage of beds in the intensive care unit at Carsview, which is why he didn't get. But I don't think the consultant would admit that.
Something that would come out in an inquiry,
mm-hmm.
because that would
yes.
be the kinds of questions that you'd be able to explore. So mm-hmm. it's a mechanism by which you get to ask those questions, I think,
yes.
that we're wanting to look at further.
Yeah.
I think we have agreed there for the Scottish Government, Scottish Patients Association, Sam H, but I think it is something, there's a whole number of issues that we would want to explore further in terms of general procedures, so if people are agreed to that action.
Yes.
Okay, in that case, can I thank you both very much for coming along. We really appreciate what you said to us today, and I think we would hope that, you know, the kinds of points you've made will inform very much the work of the Petitions Committee going forward in relation to this petition. Can I say to you that this now concludes our consideration of petitions for today. Can I thank all members, petitioners and other witnesses for their contributions to today's meeting, and I now close the meeting.